Thank you all very much. Can you hear me? Okay, then I'm going to say good evening. Thanks a lot for being here. You know, it's wonderful to see all these people in San Francisco so interested in this mayoral race. And it's good for our city because it means you get informed and then you go out and inform your family and friends. So let's get started. As you know, as you can see, we have six candidates for mayor present here. And here's the format we're going to use tonight. The candidates will each have 1 minute to answer questions you and the audience submit, as well as questions that have been submitted to the League of Women Voters website, www.sfvotes.org. Each candidate will answer every question. Any rebuttals may be included in the candidate's closing statement, in which they're given 2 minutes for that closing statement. The timekeepers in the first row, timekeepers, you want to raise a sign? Timekeepers will hold up a yellow card to signify to the candidates that they have 15 seconds remaining and will hold up a red card when it's time to stop. And I can be very nice. I've learned from Karen, but I will go and thank you. Okay, so we will now proceed to the questions you, the audience, have submitted. As I indicated, every candidate will answer every question, and you will each have 1 minute to answer these questions. So let us begin. Let's see. What would be good? Let's start with this one. Okay. Global climate change, of course, is in the news for here in California where we can't get water and for in the East Coast where they've got too much. So we're going to start with Mr. Graham, Kent Graham. And the first question is, how will you support ratepayer choice for increased access to renewable energy through Clean Power SF?
First of all, thank you for the League for doing this. I belong to the Sierra Club, and I'm very interested in conserving energy and water and the species that we have that are dwindling on the earth. I'm particularly interested in making sure that we don't leave the world for our children any worse off than we've received it. So it's a high priority for me to support all the environmental energy savings and water conservation that we can. I don't have a specific plan for that, but I belong to a number of organizations that do have plans and support all those causes. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Mr. Herrera?
Bueno, pues buenas tardes, good evening. Koho hoi sam kingai. And just for the League, maybe next time we can have more like translation equipment for our Spanish, Chinese, and other language speakers. Just a note suggestion. Very happy to be with you here tonight. Thank you, and thank you to the League for having this forum. I would start by supporting voting yes on Prop H, no on Prop G, and work, and I have planned very closely to work with Clean Power SF, Eric Brooks, and some of the folks there have already helped work our platform. Over 200 people put our platform together so we can have actually a 12-year plan that we can work together to create the clean power that we need. Secondly, I would advise everybody to start watching Cowspiracy, and we need to work on those issues of fracturing the earth and the management of cows.
Thank you very much. Mayor Lee.
Thank you. Let me begin by saying thank you to League of Women Voters as well as UCSF for hosting this and for all the audience for being out here, those that are here as well as those that will be watching virtually as well. I think the best way that I could support rates, as well as green power and clean power, would be to support the efforts that are being done with our San Francisco PUC right now as we speak. They are working on power programs that they will present to the public in San Francisco, and they are doing their homework. They're wanting to make sure it is truly green and that it is produced on a sustained basis, that it is presented in a way in which ratepayers will understand that they both have a choice, but also that they have a good choice to support our environment by making sure we have greener alternatives than the ones that they have in the private sector. I'm going to support that effort. I'll make sure that that's done. I'll make sure that these alternatives are presented properly to the voters.
Thank you very much. Mr. Martin?
I'll echo the sentiments. Thanks for hosting us here as well. And I think Clean Power SF has been something that's really important to the city of San Francisco in terms of getting ourselves to a place where we can actually gain access to fully renewable power in the city, which is something that we really haven't had access to for a long time. I think we saw this get voted through in the Board of Supervisors discussion a few years ago, and it sort of sat there. So we need to be making sure that we're moving forward in taking action on Clean Power SF. And I actually think Clean Power SF in its current state doesn't go quite far enough. I think we need to continue to evaluate what we can do in the city itself and actually turn Clean Power SF into a program that actually builds a mesh network of renewable power, solar and wind, within the city of San Francisco on rooftops that we have already in the city, so we have a more resilient and sustainable grid inside the city as well for any crises. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Schuffman?
Hi, everybody. How you doing? Thank you so much for having me. And it's good to see so many people here. Woo! Democracy. You know, I'm not going to lie. My expertise is not necessarily in Clean Power SF, but this is San Francisco. This is where the ecology movement found its base and excelled. And I know that there are enough people here who do care and are versed in it that I can work with people who are working on it to make this a greener country, a greener planet, and that San Francisco can be the future of where it all comes from. That's what I got for you.
Thank you. Ms. Weiss?
Grassroots democracy is alive and well in San Francisco. I'm so happy that everyone's come out and very appreciative to the League for putting on this debate. And I moved to San Francisco from the East Bay in 2007 to work as a sustainability strategist working to support the triple bottom line of people, planet, and equitable profit for large corporations. I almost didn't take the job when I found out we would be working with Walmart, but I decided to go into the belly of the beast and actually make change within that system. And I was shocked to find out that this administration, with our current mayor, held back on Clean Power SF by using a political maneuver to not set the rates for our Clean Power SF for over a year and a half. And so I feel like there's some lip service being played to that. And I'm excited to incorporate CCSF and Balboa Reservoir as we develop that space into being a beacon for sustainable energy in the entire globe.
Thank you very much. Keeping with the theme of our environment, the next question is, and it'll go to Mr. Herrera first. It is clear that the current transportation infrastructure in San Francisco is inadequate to accommodate the rapid influx of new residents supported by the unbridled building boom. What measures will you take to address this problem? Did everyone hear?
Yeah, that really has shown a real lack of planning, real lack of vision. And I think that we need to start by really limiting where these buses travel. They're creating a real problem, not just for the community. So we need to hold them at a space where we can where they can meet their workers at the edge of the city. We need to have them, and I will work hard to have them pay into the public common good so that they can help create a better muni for all workers together. And they would be doing a great service doing that way. This corporate cheating, corporate welfare called tax breaks just does not work, and it creates a two-tier among working people. Thank you.
Thank you. Mayor Lee.
Thank you. I believe that our city is more than interested in multiple modes of transportation, including bikes, including good walk pathways, including muni, including ride sharing, and other modes. And I think we ought to support all of those efforts to the best we can. We put together a transportation task force called Transportation 2030 to look out 25 to 30 years down the road and to see what the city needed. And I believe that they articulated for the city not only vision, but ways to get to that transportation. But we do need infrastructure money. And I am a true believer in not only making sure we extend the Central Subway to Fisherman's Wharf. I think that's going to be invaluable. I think we need to have more subway systems in the city. We need to have that second BART tube. We need to have Caltrains electrified. And we need to have the federal government and the state government support us on everything from cap and trade to more transit infrastructure monies.
Thank you very much. Mr. Martin.
That's great. That's great to hear, actually. Transportation has been sort of my passion for the last 10 years or so. I'm on the board of the San Francisco Transit Riders. Been working with them for the last 3 years. And moving, as we see all the development happening in San Francisco, we really are not, I mean, we're not even keeping pace with where the transit system needs to be 40 years ago for the population we had then. Every single building that gets built in San Francisco has to be putting money in to create the transportation offsets that it's going to create. And I think the problem that we've seen a lot in development in San Francisco is the development itself is happening to us, it's not happening by us. So what happens from that is we don't necessarily, you know, we're always going to say no, we're not going to like these developments that are happening because they're not going to provide the benefits that we need to see. And transportation is such a critical discussion that I can't talk about in a minute that goes throughout the city, throughout the region. As we talk about kind of expanding and growing transportation, we really need the commitment from the city to make that happen.
Thank you very much. Mr. Schuffman?
I met my first serious girlfriend on Muni. I love Muni. Part of being a San Franciscan is using mass transit. It's where we see people who are not like us all the time. It's where we experience what it is to be a neighbor. But Muni is a wonderful place, and it's a terrible place, too, sometimes. And there's a lot of reasons for that. But I've noticed more recently that the city feels congested. There are so many cars on the street here. And part of that's because of ride sharing. You have so many people. I meet people who come in from LA to drive their Lyft here and their Uber here. And I figure there has to be a way where we can keep ride shares for people in San Francisco by people in the Bay Area. There has to be a way we can regulate who is driving here. Also, I think that if we put a higher charge on the stops at Google buses, we could put that money into Muni and make our transit system even better. Thank you.
Thank you. Ms. Weiss?
When Bernie Sanders becomes our next president, he's going to be investing in the infrastructure and in these cities. But we need an environmental impact review for the tech buses. And there are some really exciting plans that I just saw about how we can integrate the needs of people who live and work in San Francisco with the people who are going down the peninsula. We can actually create solutions that work for everyone instead of creating that two-tiered system that Francisco was talking about. We need an environmental impact review for the TNCs for Uber and Lyft because they are congesting, and it's ridiculous that taxi drivers have had to endure what they've had to endure with the regulations that are put upon them, but they aren't being placed upon these TNCs, and the current administration is just capitulating to these large corporate interests.
Yeah. Thank you. Hi, we want to get in as many questions as we can, so if you could hold your applause to the end and then you could clap like wild. Okay, Mr. Graham.
Well, everything I do in terms of the mayor's office is going to be for the advantage of San Franciscans who live here now. I'm not so interested in what's going to happen 20 or 30 years from now. I mean, I know we have to do it, and the transportation systems, the high-speed rails, that all has to come, but everything I do is going to be on the emphasis on how do we get something done this next 6 months, this next year, because the people are standing out there in the rain at the bus stations, at the waiting for Uber and everything else they can do, or riding their bikes. I went to a bike meeting the other day, and they're all complaining about the regulations, they being ticketed and everything else. But we have to include all those modes of transportation, what we do, but we need to start solving it for the people who live here now.
Thank you very much. Okay, our next question, Mayor Lee, you'll be asked this one first, and it is, well, I can't say as mayor as this question says. So I'll say, what will you do about the huge increase in homeless families and individuals in San Francisco prior to the Super Bowl? And I'm going to do an editorial ad, and I'm going to say even after the Super Bowl.
Yeah. Here, here. Thank you. Well, I certainly, first of all, you recognize that there's a homeless challenge in our city, and we have thousands of people on the streets. It is not good for them nor anyone else that they are forced to live on the streets. So we put together our best model. We have had good models in the past. We had Homeless Connect. We had good services on the street. We have a director of hope to really bring services and coordinate with all of the different departments. But our latest model, which is the Navigation Center, we believe, puts together the best of those services, but also is inviting, gets rid of a lot of the shelter rules, and makes sure as people live in dignity as we place hundreds of units of housing behind that, so there's a long-term sustained answer. I am working, and we should work with the school district, with the human services agencies, to make sure that our children who are in school, who are homeless, get some very good focus on family homelessness, and we are putting that plan together to make sure there's housing, sustained housing for them.
Thank you so much. Mr. Martin.
Homelessness is a really big issue in San Francisco, and it's been continuing to rise. And the last sort of three administrations have talked about trying to solve homelessness, and really we've not seen that happen at all. We have from, you know, attempts to pick people up in helicopters in Golden Gate Park and ship them off to another part of the Bay Area, to Care Not Cash from under Newsom, to what we have now. I actually think the Navigation Center is an interesting model. I do think there's work that's happening on that. I think some of my other folks here have proposed interesting ideas for sanitation and for things that are necessities for folks in the city. And so I think there are a lot of different ways that we need to be tackling the problem of homelessness in San Francisco. And the first of which is making sure that we're treating everybody with respect and that we take a housing first policy ultimately. And housing first can't just be something that we do within the city limits of San Francisco. This has to be something that we do on a regional level and look at how we can manage housing both as infill in the city but also in the region so that we can get people into places so that they always have shelter as needed. And then we work with the services to get them kind of back into society and working in space.
Thank you. Mr. Shuffman?
So there's roughly 10,000-ish homeless people on the streets of San Francisco, and there's roughly 10,000-ish Airbnb rentals out there. I'm just saying. But I live in SoMa. My neighbors are homeless people. I see homeless people all the time. I talk to them, and the most important thing to remember is that they are people. When the current administration said, you know, we're going to have a big party in San Francisco, it's a pre-party before the party in Santa Clara called the Super Bowl, homeless people have to get out of here, I found it appalling. Yeah. I thought that, you know, these are, you know, you have to remember, like, these are our most fragile people. These are people who are veterans. These are people who come from broken homes, people who come from abuse, people who need our help. They are our people. 71% of them were in San Francisco residences before they were on the street. And so, as you mentioned, we need housing first. It's been proven, it works, it gets people into homes where they can get, you know, help they need, whether it's services, treatment, and what else.
Thank you. Ms. Weiss?
I have a background in transitional housing, mental health, reactivating spaces, starting urban gardens. I have been thinking about this for the last year. I came up with an idea called transitional eco-villages, where we identify all of the underutilized city property. And there's a fellow named Nicholas de Monchot from Berkeley who actually did a project, and you can look it up online, where he indexed all of the underutilized spaces in San Francisco currently. And there are many of them. And so what we do is we create these transitional eco-villages. And because Ed Lee has you know, created a catalyst out of the Super Bowl for homelessness. I call it the St. Francis Super Bowl Homelessness Challenge. For $5 million, we can actually do this. I know how to stretch a budget. I reactivated a community garden and did programming for 2 years on a budget of less than $10,000. We have the skill, we have the financing, we have the heart, we have the Burning Man headquarters to be able to do this in San Francisco and do beautiful things and take pride in how we treat our homeless neighbors.
Thank you. Mr. Graham?
Well, this is one of my personal pet peeves. Homelessness is not a crime, it's a condition. And everybody deserves a right to be respected and given the right to live in dignity. Before you can do anything, you have to go up to the person, find out why he's homeless, get a read on that. Social workers in other areas of the country do this and are able to find a way for those people to get into housing. If you have a brother in Phoenix that you could go live with for 6 months until you get on your, I mean, it's those types of things. We need more social workers involved and directly with the individuals. You can't let them, I mean, the center's good. I like the center idea, and I'd propose one as well. But you've got to have an understanding of what each player needs. And if you don't have that, then you're dead in the water. So I need to use the budget to get more social workers.
Thank you. Mr. Herrera?
Yeah, it's a very long road to homelessness, in fact, and to treat people who are on the streets as if they're somehow choosing to be there is a great mistake. Homelessness starts at the moment that people can't pay the rent, and the lack of planning and vision that has happened here in the last few years has created and devastated this problem even more. There's folks who have jobs in Sunset who are living in their cars. There's 2,700 children in the school district living in cars, in living rooms, on couches. Right now there's a lot more than 10,000 people that are actually homeless. And I think what we need to do is Proposition F gives us one part how we can start, and so we all have to support Prop F, and we have to continue to support the systems that are helping people deal with their own experience of homelessness. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Our next question, and it'll go to Mr. Martin first. Do you believe we should review San Francisco's sanctuary city policy?
Well, that's either a quick or a long-winded answer. In general, I actually don't think we should. I strongly agree with the sanctuary policy that we have as a city. I think it's a really important piece. I do think there may be some pieces of that that we're not, that we weren't doing effectively, I think, in the particular case that I'm assuming that we're sort of referring to. But I think as a general trend, I think this idea that San Francisco is a welcoming place for people around the world has been one of the trademarks that set San Francisco apart as a city. And I'd really hate to lose that over some, you know, very specific incidents that have occurred.
Thank you, Mr. Schiffman.
I am 100% for sanctuary cities. I've worked in restaurants and bars most of my life, and the people who I've worked with are the hardest working people I know. The people who, most of them are immigrants, and they are the backbone of this country, they're the backbone of this state, they're the backbone of this city. We would fall apart without them. And they need to come here and know that they are safe. That said, I don't think that that should apply to people who are violent criminals. So we should do our best to work with agencies who are getting people who are violent criminals out of our system so that those laws aren't protecting them. And there are people who are obeying the laws can actually use them to full capabilities, like the sanctuary cities are meant for, like being able to say, hey, there's a problem on my street. This person's beating his wife. This person is in a gang. There's problems over here. And they can feel safe calling the police without worrying about being deported themselves.
Thank you. Ms. Weiss?
I support Sanctuary City as well. And if I had been mayor with this tragic incident that occurred recently, I would take accountability for the fact that I signed Due Process for All into law. And I would take accountability for the fact that Sheriff McCreamy was actually doing his job and not detaining someone. But then I would actually work with Jeff Adachi, who actually did a great talk on SFGov TV. You can watch it. Talk with Casa Justa. Put together a forum where we're talking about, in that particular case, did we learn anything that we want to adjust how we respond to these issues when they come up? Because that's what you should be doing as a leader. Instead of pointing fingers, you should be taking accountability and creating forums for being able to assess things and adjust them, because the law is a living thing and we can adjust it in service to the greater good.
Thank you very much. Mr. Graham?
I agree with Amy. We have a problem with how we look at the law. Sanctuary cities are important. San Francisco is the ultimate sanctuary city. Let's face it. We welcome everybody and anybody, but we can't let the criminals go wild on the street. But what we do need to do is manage the process, and we haven't done that well. The sheriff's department and the police department don't know what each other is doing. The mayor has to get involved and get in their faces and get things squared away there. So I think it's a management issue. I think we need to keep it.
Thank you very much. Mr. Herrera?
Yeah, I would actually strengthen sanctuary cities. Mexico is at war. El Salvador is experiencing 22 murders per night. Honduras is the most violent country thanks to the coup d'etat that President Obama and Ms. Hillary supported and blessed. We are experiencing tremendous changes. People are here fleeing real violence. My own brother-in-law was murdered and disappeared. Sanctuary cities provide safety, and the fact that we have allowed Mr. Donald Trump to sacrifice and to manipulate the tragic death, accidental death of a young woman, and is a disgrace. I think it's a disgrace, and I think we should take leadership across the country to defend the life of people who are here for a protection from war, violence, and torture. Thank you.
Thank you. Mayor Lee.
Clearly, I understand the goals of our sanctuary city policy, and let me say this. I think it's more than a policy. It is a live document, and I agree with the number of comments here made that not only do we want to protect and have a sanctuary for those that are fleeing, but once they're here, we've got to have the programs to support their success. Because we have a policy, I was at the helm with other mayors when we created the ID card. For those who are undocumented, the ID card has served thousands of people to be able to get and access services. We put money, serious money, in the pathways to citizenship so that we can train all of these folks to not just be a beneficiary of the policy, but be successful in their lives, access to education, to driver's licenses, to jobs without those barriers. I think that we need to do more. We will continue to do more to support our immigrants. It shouldn't matter where the legality of their documentation is. We ought to help them out and help them succeed.
Thank you very much. The next question will go to Mr. Schuffman first. The black population is at 6% and declining in San Francisco. What issues are causing this, and what will you do to address them?
It's a housing issue, like pretty much everything right now. In the next 10 years, there's gonna be a lot of development in the Bayview, Hunters Point. And that's almost inevitable unless everything craps the bucket. So what I'd like to do is put a first right of refusal for everybody who's from the Bayview, Hunters Point, or who's been displaced from the Bayview, Hunters Point. Not only that, I think we should build specifically a whole bunch of affordable housing there. Like a ton, in fact, all over the city. But if we want to maintain the small, 6% of our African American population, we need to build, pardon me?
According to the.
Right, we need to build now in Bayview Hunters Point and not wait till, you know, it rolls around.
Thank you. Ms. Weiss?
James Baldwin came to San Francisco in 1963. There's an amazing documentary that you should all watch if you haven't, called Take This Hammer. And he talked about the institutionalized racism that was happening with redevelopment and the fact that people couldn't get jobs after World War II. And so what we need to be doing is creating pathways to prosperity for our young African-American neighbors rather than pipelines to prison. And we need to be creating job opportunities through Clean Power SF, which could already be underway if this administration had allowed for Clean Power SF to be rolling forward. And we need to, like, I love Stuart's idea of first right of refusal, and also to support people who have certificates of preference, to who have been displaced in the past through redevelopment, to be able to come back into the city, and to be able to focus on Bayview's Hunters Point and the Fillmore Western Addition area, and figure out how can we be creating more housing through additional dwelling units that support the property owners that are currently there, and to link them to African American neighbors.
Thank you. Mr. Graham.
I agree with that, but what we need to do is create jobs. I mean, it was a tragedy that we let the 49ers go down to Santa Clara when a stadium right there would have created a whole neighborhood of jobs and a workforce that could go right into that neighborhood. We can still do that, but we need some corporate help with that. I think the issue is jobs and education for those that don't have it, job training for those people. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Herrera?
Yeah, I would start by supporting Proposition I and making it go citywide. I think there's been some sort of a redlining that's been happening to kick out the African-American community, and that's a terrible thing that has happened. So we need to not just hold the fort, but bring people back. Over half of the city workers cannot afford to live in San Francisco. We have a serious housing problem and crisis created by this runaway housing market that's been created. The top problem that's facing all of our communities is precisely that we have let investors act like developers. They're not developers. We are the developers. They are investors. They're here to make money, and we have to be clear, we are here to live and produce. So we have to produce housing that allows our people to come back, particularly African American community, and support the Midtown project, that what's been happening up here in the Fillmore.
Thank you. Mayor Lee.
We have to have a multi-pronged approach. I think one of the biggest challenges for the African American families that had been here is intergenerational poverty that results from having isolated poverty housing we call public housing for many decades, and people were satisfied with that. We should never be satisfied with that. People need to have a pathway forward. It has to include early education. Now we have universal preschool programs for people. Has to have intervention, has to have counseling at the public schools. We are having that because of Prop C and our passage for families, youth, and children. And when we began the middle grades, we knew that the statistics primarily were African-American and Latino that were failing and that were leaving our public education at the middle school level. We are now investing that at the historic levels that we've ever had. Education, job training, all of our industries that we have, whether it's tourism, tech, manufacturing, tourism, they all should have aspects to it to do job training targeted at low-income youth.
Thank you. We're all being civil. I'm sorry so many of you have caught colds. I know it's a little cool in here. Mr. Martin?
To me, I think, you know, the origins go back to how we treat neighborhoods and how we treat communities. And, you know, during the urban renewal timeframe, development was happening to a community. It was not happening by that community. And we're seeing the same thing happening again today. And we can call it something different. We can call it not urban renewal, whatever we want to do. But we need to take ownership of the development that's happening in San Francisco, and we need to create development by San Franciscans and for San Franciscans. And I actually don't like our affordable housing model. I don't like the idea that a developer comes into San Francisco, and I don't care whether it's 20% or 30% or 40% affordable. Anytime you have an external investor investing in housing and creating a percentage of that affordable, it's not in alignment with what we actually need in San Francisco for what we want. And so I think we really need to review what development means and who's doing the development and how we're doing that in San Francisco in general.
Yeah. Thank you.
Okay, then the next question, and we're going to start with Ms. Weiss. According to an SF Weekly cover story on pretrial detention, over half the people in county jail in San Francisco at any given time have not been convicted of any crime. They are there because they are too poor to afford bail. What would you do to address this?
Well, this actually happened to a friend of mine who lives in an RV, who's been living in San Francisco in an RV for many years, who has a mental health challenge. And what happened was she got a ticket on her bike, and then she wasn't able to pay the fee. And I actually loaned her $300 so that she wouldn't have to go to jail and have a warrant out for her arrest. I mean, this is happening where people are getting criminalized for being homeless, and we need to stop the criminalization of homelessness. That's one huge thing that would make a difference in this way. And we need to figure out strategies for crime reduction that aren't with people who are armed on our streets. I think we can come up with a Stewards of Peace program where they're unarmed safety programs, and that's going to actually contribute to less crime and leading to these types of things. But we just need, if more people had opportunities and support through jobs and mental health, then I think we would avoid them being in jail in the first place.
Thank you. Mr. Graham?
Yeah, I agree with Amy. One of the things is that I don't believe in is policing for profit, and I think that's happening over and over again. I mean, you get a ticket in San Francisco for a wrong left turn, $391. I mean, who can afford that, really? Even people that make some money don't want to pay that kind of money for a wrong left turn. So, you know, it just adds more impetus for keeping people in jail when they know they can't pay it. So we need to make things reasonable for what the crime is, and then we won't have half the people that we have in jail.
Thank you very much. Mr. Herrera?
Yeah, first of all, respects and honor to the work that Rosmer Karimi has done. I think it's a fabulous work. I think it's important for the mayor to take steps to be in communication with Mr. McRimi. I think the level of corruption that people feel as at City Hall right now only nourishes the experience of people saying there is no respect for the law. But then to add that to the criminalization of the homeless, criminalization of youth, criminalization of folks who don't have the money to pay is part of the bigger problem that we're seeing here. And it comes right back, lack of political will at City Hall, and it comes back to the crisis that people are experiencing right now, because the level of anxiety is going throughout the city, not just folks in the street, but actual city workers who cannot afford to live here.
Thank you, Mayor Lee.
I'm a true believer in alternatives to incarceration, and I know that at the heart of it, as I said earlier, we've got to figure out better ways to prevent people from going to jail and also being incarcerated. Those programs do include better education, but also the job training that we have for the new workforce. At the same time, you're already seeing decreases in our jails and increases in paid jobs, internship jobs, and the jobs that people can have for sustained periods. But we also need to make sure that those that are already incarcerated have alternatives to that. And I'm a true believer in diversion and also community justice courts to make sure that the problems that people face can be resolved at that level and not as a result of long-term incarceration. If the people in incarcerated situations don't get the opportunity to learn job skills while they are incarcerated, coming out, they're also worse, and that's going to also exacerbate the problem.
Thank you. Mr. Martin.
Yeah, I think the community courts is actually a great example of what we can be doing a lot better in that case. I think if it really is half of people in jail, that's ridiculous. If they're just simply not able to pay bail, that's an incredible statistic. I think that's obviously not acceptable. I think we need to do things certainly to decrease the amount of sort of frivolous reasons why people are getting caught up in the system. But I think we also need to reevaluate what sorts of crimes people are getting, prosecute of, and what kind of bail they're being expected to pay of that, because that seems astronomical. I think it's really important, to echo sort of what I'm hearing on the stage. I think we have to be responding to crises, especially as we talked about homelessness earlier. We need to be responding to crises of housing and food or mental illness with someone who's not going to show up as police and not going to treat them like they're criminal and end up in the justice system. That's not the place that we need to be putting that. And so if we can remove that burden, if a lot of that is coming from that, then we need to take full steps to stop that.
Thank you, Mr. Schuffman.
I read recently that something like 45 or 50% of our inmate population are African American, which is absurd considering that our African American population is only 6% of the city. So I think we need to relook at the way we police people. And there's obviously a bias there if those numbers are real. Beyond that, we need to look at what we look at as criminal. Things like homelessness shouldn't be criminal. Things like prostitution, we should decriminalize that. Because who cares what you're doing with your body as long as you're safe. So if we raise the bar of what you go to jail for, there'll be less people in jail. And if we police our members of society better, once again, there'll be less people in jail.
Thank you very much. The next question goes to Mr. Graham, and it is, as mayor, would you support the current plan to make Yerba Buena Island 95% luxury housing with only 5% temporary affordable housing, or would you change the plan to include a greater percentage of permanent affordable housing?
Gee, let me think who this crowd would really want to hear about this. No, I don't agree with that. I mean, I think it should represent the same levels that we have here in the city, and the city is getting too gentrified as it is. So I'd make changes to that plan.
Thank you very much. Mr. Herrera?
Affordable housing is priority. We have so many people, as we've already been saying. I think that the toxicity of the Treasure Island, Yerba Buena Island, the whole area needs to be really taken a look at and cleaned up. I think we need to support very much the citizenry who's been fighting strongly to keep folks there. We have to continue to do that and put all our effort to help people remain and open up more space for people to be able to live there. Affordable housing.
Thank you. Mayor Lee.
Maxine, I believe that the question you had was referencing an agreement that was passed by the board many years ago, and it calls for Yerba Buena to have primarily market rate, but support Treasure Island's 25% affordable housing units. And that's a serious number. The developers have agreed to do that, so it's already inked, so there's not much you can do about it unless you stop the development. And I do believe that there is a path forward to increase that amount. The state recently passed legislation that allows infrastructure financing through assembly bills, and the governor signed it, and we have additional, and we're in conversations now as to whether or not we can get from up to 30% and maybe even exceed that with the collaboration and cooperation of the rights of the developer that have the legal rights to develop the island. They're obviously going to spend a huge amount of money making sure that island is safe. If they got to deal with sea level rise, but they've already got a minimum commitment of 25%. I'm sure we can up it if we have the right negotiations.
Thank you. Mr. Martin? Excuse me. Civil. Mr. Martin?
I do not agree with that plan. The development that's happening on Yerba Buena and Treasure Island first of all, I actually have no idea how in the world we're going to build a bunch of units and get them back and forth into the city, because we have no transportation policy that involves that island. So they're going to go in cars on the Bay Bridge, I guess, but I'm not sure what's going to happen with that. So, you know, we really need to think about transportation to that space. But I think in general, you know, like we've been talking about, it really comes down to the same question ultimately of who's doing the developing, who gets to live in that space, and why this is happening. And I think, you know, Mayor Lee actually just mentioned that the only way you would stop that is by stopping development. And that's something that's actually been talking about, right, obviously. And so I think those are the reasons why I actually support the moratorium in San Francisco, because it needs to put the city into a position where it has to make difficult decisions about how development is happening in this city. And right now, they're not being forced to do that, and we're still talking whether it's 20 or 30%, and neither of those is going to cut it.
Yeah. Thank you. Mr. Shuffman?
I'm okay with it if we put 4 navigation centers there, too. Why not? When we put up if you want to have 95% of luxury housing, we should put a couple navigation centers there too, so you know what the rest of the world is like. And then build affordable housing 100% on Treasure Island.
More?
No, that's it.
Okay. Thank you, Ms. Weiss.
How many people in this room want a mayor who has the political will to demand more than 50% affordable housing on Treasure Island? And that's what you need in City Hall, is you need political will in order to make sure that development is, like my colleagues here on the forum here, as Reed has said, as Stuart has said, we need to ensure that development is supporting the needs of people who work in San Francisco and be able to have the proper types of transportation that allow this to be sustainable. We need to be thinking 50 years down the road, as is this even sustainable to be building in that way? Because what about sea level rise and what about earthquakes? And so I haven't really been given enough information yet to feel really sound about that development, and I would like there to be more happening in that way. But we can definitely make it pencil out. I can work with the accountants for these developers to show them how it pencils out for them to get more than 50% affordable.
Yeah. Thank you. Mr. Herrera, how would you protect renters and legacy businesses from those that force them out for profit?
Yeah, we've been looking at that piece actually in terms of creating a commercial rent control, but we have to actually start organizing at the state level because of legislature there. So I would start by sending Mark Leno out to fight for us on that piece and really do it. Secondly, I think the way that the legacy piece is written, it doesn't really support enough of the small businesses, the Prop J I'm talking about, that really to make a difference. I think we have to once again come back to political will, and I think first of all we need to stop these investors from kicking out our small business people. We need to apply some real protections like evictions 2.0. We have to also apply that protection to the small businesses. Small businesses are the ones that keep the economy going here in our city. So we need a serious political will to protect small business, medium business in San Francisco.
Thank you. Mayor Lee?
I'm a supporter of legacy businesses. I've been in this city now for over 35 years, and of course I've seen some of my, whether stores or restaurants or places where people have gathered for many, many years and felt that that was a loss in their neighborhood. I also support neighborhood efforts to make sure that the quality of the changes are reflective of what the neighborhood needs as well. This is why we have very strong Invest in Neighborhoods programs in the city. We funded those. We funded a lot of small business grants that make sure things that small businesses find difficult to get, whether they're market rate loans to do simple things like change their awnings or make sure that they have better lighting. We've been doing that to the tune of hundreds of thousands of dollars in a lot of different corridors and assisting those small businesses sustain and become successful, and then provide them with good corridors as well that are safe and well lit.
Thank you. Mr. Martin.
So it sounds like we agree on protecting legacy businesses, businesses that have been around for a while. I think we have a lot of work to do, as Francisco mentioned, on a state level. We can't actually enact rent control due to a law of the past, I believe, in the 70s. But there are some things we can do in terms of forcing sort of conversations to happen with landlords and tenants and at least buying some time. I think that's really important. I also want to talk about, in general, small business and local business in San Francisco, because the rents for their properties are incredibly high. And, you know, I've been talking to, the gentleman who runs the corner market near me, and, I mean, his rents are going up over $10,000 a month. And this is for a corner market, so he can't run a corner market in that space. And, you know, a lot of these types of things we're seeing in neighborhoods all over the city. And I think these aren't necessarily legacy businesses. These are ones that maybe have been around for short periods of time. So we need to have kind of a comprehensive increase of commercial retail space in the city. We need to look at garage conversions. We need to look at lots of different options to create a lot more retail space than we have. And I also have a plan called Marklets, which is a small business incubation, where we give them space for a revenue share model instead.
Thank you. Mr. Shuffman?
Our current mayor, Mayor Ed Lee, gave $55 million worth of tax breaks to huge businesses in mid-market. I would have rather seen that those tax breaks go to support our independent businesses that have been around for a while. Yeah. Those businesses are the ones that make San Francisco. Twitter doesn't make San Francisco San Francisco. I mean, sure, it's nice they cleaned up mid-market a little bit, but that money could be used in far better ways. Another thing, I'd like the idea of talking at the state level about making rent control for businesses, as well as maybe taking what it means to be a legacy business and making it 20 years instead of 30 years. 30 years is a long time. Mm-hmm. And there's plenty of great businesses that have been around for 20 years that are now in peril of, you know, their lease being over and the landlord wanted to jack it up 300%, 400%. We're losing amazing local businesses every day. We just lost Dave's bar on 3rd Street the other day.
Thank you, Ms. Weiss.
I would like to believe what Mayor Ed Lee just said, but I know it's disingenuous firsthand because it's what got me activated in politics in San Francisco in the first place. It was a Chase Bank that the Ed Lee's Office of Economic and Workforce Development and the Planning Department rolled out the red carpet to take three independent storefronts. One of them, this guy Mario, who ran Country Cheese through hard times in Divisadero, he's the very story of the American dream. And Ed Lee allowed him to be kicked out by Chase Bank, which caused the global financial collapse. And it was outrageous to me because the law was being broken. And that was what got me activated in local politics, because I said, how can the law possibly be broken for Chase Bank in our communities? And instead of just saying no to that kind of displacement, I said, I'm going to start a nonprofit called Neighbors Developing Divisadero, where we invest in inclusive, culturally enriching, and sustainable development. And I've dedicated the last 4 years of my life to that.
Thank you. Thank you, I applaud your enthusiasm, but we'd like to get as many questions in as possible. Thank you so much. Mr. Graham.
Well, I've been going around to all the homeowner and merchant associations for the last 3 months, and primarily the number one complaint is if a big box store or any of their current favorite neighborhood haunts are going to go under. They're trying desperately to keep those things in their neighborhoods. So we need to support any kind of legislation we can get to keep San Francisco looking like San Francisco. I mean, it's the reason I moved here in the first place. I lived in a place that had a Denny's, opposite a McDonald's, opposite a Safeway, opposite another 7-Eleven store, and it drove me nuts. So I came up here because the quality of living and the quality of life is much better, and we want to keep it that way.
Thank you very much. Our next question goes to the Super Bowl, which the 49ers, of course, will be in, right? But the question is, what will you do to address human trafficking as we plan for the Super Bowl? And I'm sure most of you know that that is a problem in the Bay Area. But that's the question.
How is that again? How's the question?
Okay. What will you do to address human trafficking as we plan for the Super Bowl? And it's for Mayor Lee.
I'm sorry, me?
Yeah, you
Thank
start.
You. Thank yes. you. Yeah. First of all, we are working closely with our Commission on the Status of Women and with the Super Bowl Committee to make sure that we have the best intelligence from past places around the country that host the Super Bowls and other big events and align them with the red flags that we know would be attractive to human trafficking. And with that, we are ready to hire, and we already have in the budget, some 200 people who will be out with the hotels, with the businesses that are looking for these red flags. Red flags would include places where young women might be enticed to go, and hotels would be setting up for that, or places where people are using or renting that might be servicing as places for trafficking. We are committed to making sure that we have a human trafficking free event in San Francisco and around the Bay Area. We are also talking about other jurisdictions outside of San Francisco cooperating with us as well.
Thank you. Mr. Martin?
I honestly don't know enough about how human trafficking and Super Bowls relate to each other in terms of the specifics of how that works. So I can't comment a whole lot on that. In general, I think we need to be watching out for those types of things, and we need to be treating people with respect and equal rights. I think in terms of on our streets, if we're seeing situations related to human trafficking, then we have to do things about them. But I mean, that's about the extent that I know on that topic. Yeah.
Thank you. Mr. Shookman?
I am pro-sex worker. I think you should be able to do with your body what you want to do with your body, but I obviously against human trafficking. I don't know how we stop that. I think that if, as a country, we were able to decriminalize prostitution or even legalize it, it would be able to cut down on that majorly. On a local level, I would have to work with the forces that are already here who are already tackling that situation.
Thank you. Ms. Weiss?
I think those were great answers that came before me. I'm also pro-sex worker, but interested in maintaining that people have the ability to be safe in that process. And, you know, I was actually talking to someone who works on Mission Street and was telling me that there are two prostitution SROs that he knows of, like, and everybody knows about it, but nobody's doing anything about it. And the question is, are the people that are working there, you know, doing so freely? And are they being treated right and having the right kind of health precautions? And I look forward to learning more about how I can be a force for helping to stop human trafficking because, to be quite honest, I'm not very well versed in that particular issue.
Thank you. Mr. Graham?
Well, there's a TV documentary that documents this about a task force here in San Francisco that's gone out and looked at some of the massage parlors and like that. I don't think this is a Super Bowl issue. I think it's an issue of everyday slavery. It's a travesty that happens in our city. It's something that should be looked at very seriously. Now, again, I'm in favor of legalizing prostitution and putting them in brothels and providing health care and all that. But we're talking about young girls that are, you know, imported from Thailand and China and a lot of different places, including the United States. But we've got to put an effort into that that makes it a priority to stop that.
Thank you. Mr. Herrera?
Yeah, I want to separate sex workers who are adults and are doing what they know they're doing from the trafficking of women and children and even men in this sense. But I think the key problem is precisely what we're facing with the housing crisis, because it follows the model of might makes right. You have enough money, you do whatever the hell you want. And that's what we're seeing in this city is. And so we've made the mistake of thinking that Adam Smith's invisible hand is the sleight of hand of corruption. And human trafficking is abuse. It happens in the Super Bowl because there's so much movement of people, and so much we have to actually address the patrons, right? It's white collar crime is what it is. And so we have to address the people who are paying for it instead of criminalizing the folks on the street and youth. We have to start looking at the white collar, or maybe white part of this crime.
Thank you. Okay, the next question, and it'll go to Mr. Martin. In over 20 years of living in the city, I have never seen the city so dirty. What would you do to improve the status of our sidewalks and public spaces?
So first of all, I think it just takes a commitment from the city that that's something that we want to do. I think if we have the staff and the resources to get out there and actually clean the streets and recognize that that's something that the city wants, I think that's fine. I think there's sort of an undertone in a lot of those questions that maybe assume something other than just maybe litter or gum or something like this stuck on the street. And
no, I'm talking about litter and gum on the street. I've never seen it so filthy in all my life.
Oh, that's perfect. Thank Is that
you.
Your question?
Nope. Excuse me, yeah. Sir.
Well, so in that case, I think it's perfect. You know, I've spent a lot of time in cities around the world, and they have full staffs that are out all the time cleaning sidewalks and streets. And I think that's something that we need to collectively, as a community, decide that if we want to have that happen, we need to do that. And I think it's a great thing for San Francisco to do.
Thank you, Mr. Shuffman.
There is a lot of poop on our streets. And it's not dog poop, it is human poop. And it's because there are a lot of people on our streets. And homelessness is a bigger issue, but we can solve our poop problem very easily. We have a whole bunch of bathrooms that have been closed since 9/11 and a little bit afterwards, in Muni, in BART, in public parks. This administration's movement to privatize our parks is actually closing more bathrooms. We need to open these bathrooms up. Plus, if we put a 1% tax on every new construction unit going up in the city, every new high-rise, at a very, very conservative cost, we can open 70 new bathrooms that are 24 hours on the streets of San Francisco. It's called the Portland Loo, and they're safe. They're almost indestructible, and there's grading on the tops and the bottoms, so that way police can walk by and see how many pairs of feet are in there, so that nobody's actually living in there. We can solve our poop problem very easily, and I'd like to see it happen now.
Thank you. Ms. Weiss?
To build off of that, you know, in a city of innovation, I actually went to the Urban Prototyping Festival that happened from the Gray Area Foundation for the Arts 4 years ago, and there was this amazing thing called the pea planter, where it was a urinal that the plants actually helped to dilute and support the process. And so this was something that was created 4 years ago, and if I was mayor, you can bet that we would have a lot of these on our streets right now. And, you know, I see people who are going and picking up cans and sifting through garbage cans. If they could be treated with dignity, if we could figure out a way for people to get an honest day's work and some money off of doing something that's in service to the community with these pathways where there wasn't as much red tape in terms of having to go through the normal employment channels, I feel like there's an opportunity for people to be contributing their skills to beautifying our city.
Thank you. Mr. Graham?
Yeah, I think that's true. You take the problem away at the core by putting bathrooms somewhere. I mean, even under the freeways where people are putting up tents and things like that, you put a bathroom there or all over the place. I mean, if I was mayor, I'd hire Stewart to get right on this problem, because he's got the answers and he's got the history of all of this going on. So we can clean that up, and we can also get some machines that clean gum off the street and trash and put somebody else to work using those.
Thank you, Mr. Herrera.
Yes, that is a very good video, Stewart. You know, I always wonder about that, because I do see that there's a political will to do that in the Embarcadero. I keep wondering what a federal agent's gun was doing in the Embarcadero, by the way. The question that's never asked. But I think what has to happen is precisely there. That's a good example. What's happened in Embarcadero, where they do try to keep the gum and the trash off the streets, needs to continue throughout the city. And it helps to provide a lot of jobs, that helps to create sustainability, and it's linked with political will and vision and planning, which is one of the big voids right now with our administration.
Thank you, Mayor Lee.
Someone put the trash on the street. And I think that while we have many programs that pick it up or that clean it off, monitors on toilets, potty patrols, paint that sprays back, We have all of that. But ultimately, I think it comes down to personal responsibility, because the trash got there by somebody. And we have to go back with our youth, with our school systems and our programs to say, you know, okay, you're going to eat something while you're walking, but why do you have to stand in a corner and throw it on the curb? Why aren't we preventing that from happening? It's almost a sense of something that's gotten away from just decent respect for each other on our streets. And I do think that everybody, there shouldn't be a blame of any particular group. It's about everybody, whether you're standing waiting for Muni, whether you're coming out of fast food or a restaurant, everybody does it. And when we won the World Series a couple of years ago, we did the great sweep with the Giants, and we've got 10,000 kids that have learned new habits to prevent trash from getting on the streets.
Thank you. Our next question, and it goes to Mr. Shuffman first. As mayor, how will you ensure that tech companies pay their fair share of taxes?
Make them pay their taxes. I can't wait for these tax breaks to disappear, to expire. I said earlier, $55 million worth of tax breaks were given to the tech companies down in mid-market, whereas a few blocks away, St. Anthony's is struggling to feed everybody every day. There's three meals or more per person in the Twitter building, and they're struggling to feed one meal per person at St. Anthony's. We've opened our doors to corporations in this city. Mayor Lee literally almost sold City Hall for advertising. We need to take our city back and stop telling these corporations they can do whatever they want in our city. This is our city.
That's right.
Thank you. Ms. Weiss?
Well, Ron Conway was actually part of the plan to change our tax structure in San Francisco. And to be fair, there were some progressives, too, that were saying we need to change from a payroll tax in order to support new employment opportunities. But we went too far with that, and we should have put more onus on tech companies that are coming into the city to be able to pay their fair share. And that's what it's really about. I'm a systems thinker. We live in an ecosystem. We can't have one area grow without it supporting the others, or else it's imbalanced and it puts people in jeopardy. And so there needs to be a nexus between development and job growth, industry growth, and transit and sustainability, all of these things. And so, you know, I'm just shocked, by the way, at the regional housing needs assessment. Cupertino is planning on putting 20,000 more jobs in Cupertino. Do you know how many houses they're supposed to build? 1,000.
Yeah.
How that doesn't make any sense. And as mayor, I'm going to figure out how we get more balance into that system.
Thank you. Mr. Graham?
Well, I'm troubled by the amount of new development that comes in and doesn't pay their fair share and has workers from out of town. You can't keep doing that and sustain what we wanted in San Francisco. Again, I come back to what I'm about is doing something for the San Franciscans who live here now, and I think we have to tax the corporations at a rate that they need to support our current population.
Thank you. Mr. Herrera.
Thank you. I will continue to work with organizations like Local 2 that stop the Fairmont from trying to make their hotel into condominiums. This whole idea of tax breaks is nothing but corporate welfare. And it goes right along the line with privatization, which takes our public trust, our money collectively, and gives it in form of contracts to the folks that are friendly or that offer the best payment to the local politicians. So I think we need to question this whole thing of tax breaks. I've seen it as a historian, because that's exactly what Porfirio Diaz did in Mexico, which led to the Mexican Revolution. So I'm very glad we're having this people's revolt. And the key question needs to be, make the wealthy, make the investor pay their fair share.
Thank you. Mayor Lee.
This past year, we were able to pass a two-year budget that had no budget cuts to all of our nonprofits, to a number of neighborhoods. We were able to do proper investments for the first time, have enough to hire additional police officers, firefighters, 911 callers, call takers, as well as paramedics. We're able to do that because we have a very strong economy. That strong economy is a reflection of good relations with our business community to make sure that we have a good tax base to fulfill all the necessary things that we do. And we continue to do the San Francisco values of things. When the federal government decided that they would continue to cut Ryan White funds for AIDS and HIV prevention, we filled that gap with a strong economy. When the homeless challenge for veterans came before us, we're able to say with good confidence, by the end of this year, we're going to end chronic homelessness for veterans. We can do more things together with a strong economy to help our youth, to end intergenerational poverty, particularly for black families, and do all the things that we want to do, but we've got to have a strong local economy.
Thank you.
We do need a strong local economy, but we have a $9 billion budget just approved, which is one of the highest per capita budgets in the world, which is incredible if you think about that.
Yeah.
And yet we're talking about a lot of problems here tonight, right? We should be talking about all the crazy great things we're going to be doing, and instead we're talking about all these issues that are existing in our city. I think forcing corporations to pay taxes is really important, but I think San Francisco has a money problem. I think we have a corruption problem at our core. And we've had, you know, three different administrations where this has been an issue for. And my background is in tech. I work in tech. And we don't really have a tech problem. We have a corporate tech problem. And it's money that's coming from the corporate side that's working with the city. And I think we're actually, you know, I strongly support a lot of work that we do in, like, Anti-Corruption Act is a really important thing. And we just have to, you know, there's a lot of reasons why we question the current administration's ability to lead us with the sort of backroom deals that we don't know what are going on. Ron Conway is not tech, he's money. And that's, yeah, that's my stand.
Thank you very much. And if you may note, by the clock, it's already 8:05. We have many questions. Unfortunately, we can't get to all of them. And that was our last question. Now, ladies and gentlemen, thank you for your patience, and I encourage you to continue with your levels of civility and enthusiasm, and again, hold your applause till the end, but now we come to the candidates' closing statements. But first, let me remind you that if you aren't registered to vote, please do so right away. And urge others you know to register to vote. Voting is exciting. You want to do it. You want to have your friends do it. You want to have your family do it. The actual deadline is October 19th, and if you moved, you need to register again at your new address. We will do the closing statements in reverse. In reverse alphabetical order, and remember, candidates, you have 2 minutes. And we're going to start with Ms. Weiss.
Martin Luther King said that power is at its best when it's in service to love and justice. And it's important for us to understand that the only tool that's available to us to be able to acquire that power is grassroots democracy. And that's why I'm so excited that everybody is out here tonight and there's a growing momentum for people to understand that when our leaders are not accountable to us, when they're not using that power in a way that gives us an exciting vision for the future that's truly inclusive and equitable, that's good for the planet, and that provides for equitable profit, then we need to become those leaders. And that's what we're doing here tonight. I'm urging everybody to use ranked choice voting in order to vote 1, 2, 3 to replace the current administration with a people-powered candidate. And, you know, like I said, I got my start in local politics because I saw that the law was being broken. I like to joke that at least Gavin Newsom broke the law for gay people and for love. But what's been happening lately is that the law is being broken for corporations. And we need someone to come in with a level head, someone that can work with all sides and be a bridge between these groups. And I, you know, had a meeting at Google. I can talk to Scott Wiener. I just asked Scott Wiener, actually, you know, with Prop F, really, Scott, you really don't want the law to be able to allow us to get the data so that we could enforce this regulation? And he said, you know, I really don't have a problem with that. I have a problem with the 75-day cap. So this is the kind of stuff that we do, is we figure out what's going on, we assess, we work with both sides, and we come up with solutions. I have come up with solutions to our housing crisis that can actually make people excited about the future of development. Wouldn't it be wonderful to be excited about the future of development in San Francisco? If I'm your next mayor, then you can be.
Thank you very much. Mr. Shuffman.
I'd like to start off by saying I've seen her video about development, and you need to see it. It's amazing. I highly recommend it. I came to San Francisco because people say they leave their heart in San Francisco. I found my heart in San Francisco. I found a community. I found a place where everybody was welcome, no matter where they were from or what they did or what they were like. People who were not welcome anywhere else were always welcome in San Francisco, and that's what we're losing. Part of that has to do with housing. A lot of that has to do with corruption. Which has a lot to do with housing as well. I know. It's sad that people are afraid of people like Ron Conway and their money. It's so sad that there's a guy named Brokeass Stewart who's doing well in this election.
Yeah.
I shouldn't have to be doing this, but I'm doing it, and I'm proud to be doing it. This administration. where do I even begin? I'm going to stop looking at these fucking things. All right, so look. We need to take our city back. We need to get the money out of politics. The corporate money is ruining our city. We got to stop giving them tax breaks. And we have to start thinking about our communities and the best sustainable ways to keep them together. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Martin.
So I didn't quite prepare any two-minute speech, but I got into this race because we are at a sort of unprecedented moment in the city of San Francisco. We have an economic boom, which we haven't seen since, I guess, the gold rush, and we're not seeing the positive changes that we need to be seeing. And so I look at this as a sort of a systemic problem across the board, right? We need to look at housing systemically. We need to look at the whole process. We need to create a market for people developing housing inside of San Francisco for San Franciscans, like I've said before, and that needs to go across the board. We need to look at rent. We need to evaluate the role of rent control, what we're doing with rent control today. I have another plan called Balanced Rent, which actually takes into account income so we can create an equitable future for people who currently live here, but also for people who need to move here and don't have very top high-end salaries. We need to be looking at transportation. We have a comprehensive transportation network, and right now in San Francisco, it's still one of the slowest networks in the country. We can do a lot better with transportation, both from, you know, putting more funding and investment. A great example is looking at how we could build a subway across the city because it costs $2 billion, $3 billion, which is an incredible amount of money, but it can operate at 90% reduction in operational costs over what we do, say, on Geary with 120 buses during rush hour. So we can do things with comprehensive transportation in the city. We need to look at it regionally. We need a regional transportation network that goes beyond the city. And the next piece that we need to talk about is local business. And we really need to be reinvesting in our local business today and giving people a path forward, because being able to create a new business in San Francisco has an incredibly high bar of entry right now. And we need to be lowering that barrier so you can start your business with very, very minimal cost. And that comes down to a program that I've called Marklets, which allows you to create similar to Parklets and new businesses without paying the overhead for the space. There's so many different ideas that I just want to be talking to you about, that I want to be exploring and figuring out how we can make happen. And that's why I got into this race, and I would really hope that you all appreciate that too. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Mayor Lee.
Let me begin by thanking each and every one of the people here on this stage for throwing their hat into the ring. It's an incredible opportunity to be the mayor of San Francisco, one of the greatest cities in the world, not just in the state of California. 4.5 years ago, I had the opportunity to run for mayor, and in that time, people from all over the different neighborhoods asked if we can make sure this city created more jobs for them. We were coming out of the worst recession ever. People were looking for all kinds of answers, but they ultimately wanted jobs. They wanted to work their way forward to success in this city. And the reason that I concentrated with supervisors on mid-market was that that portion of our most famous avenue, every third storefront was empty. Porno shops, every block. Cash centers that fed on our welfare recipients were proliferated, and there was misery in that whole site. So I'd made myself, but I also made a promise to a lot of other people that we would show our efforts there as to how to clean it up. Well, guess who led that effort? It was local artists, not tech companies, as many of you believe. It was the Gray Arts Foundation. It was Burning Man. It was the arts organization that took the risk and that I am continuing to support and make sure that they are with me on the total effort to revitalize market. Yes, the companies took advantage at our invitation to come in for 6-year exemption. And guess what? It's revitalizing. It is a lot more small businesses are coming in. The stores that have been there historically have increased their patronage by 3- or 4-fold. And the stories go on, and will continue to do that. But I think, and I continue to say, that a strong, economically founded city is going to be able to help a lot more people. And we're demonstrating that with all the programs that we have. It is a privilege to be the mayor, and I humbly ask for your support.
Thank you. Civility, please. Mr. Herrera.
You don't want me to come back again. So calm it down.
Mr. Herrera.
40,000 jobs, but for people who don't live here. Our 10,000 people have been kicked out of the Mission. The Bayview, Hunters Point have been completely devastated. People are feeling the angst, a general angst, at what this has created. So this planning is not for us. We have to come back to plan and develop for our communities. Listen to the wisdom of our communities. The Coalition for Homelessness has a great 5-year plan. Day laborers, Mujeres Unidas, groups throughout the city have created plans and projects. The people's budget, the own master plan of the city, which creates limits on heights of buildings. Our communities have the wisdom to build and create a city where we can live, where our children can grow up, our grandchildren can grow up. It's our decision to do that together. And that's what we need to develop. Not the wishes of investors that come from outside. They come to make a buck. They can do part of their little Russian roulette game. They can do with part of the city. But we have to control the land in which we live. What kind of city do we want? And I'll leave it with this little cliche song. I give my heart to San Francisco, affordability for you and me. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Graham.
Well, I'm not going to sing. Who could top that anyway? I don't have to be in this race. I'm retired. I'm self-sufficient. I don't need the salary. Matter of fact, if I get the salary, I'm going to kick some of that into social workers and things that I believe in. But I came here to run because I think I can do something for the city. As you've heard, we have this giant budget, and I'm a great manager of budgets. I've managed 400 very large budgets in hospitals over the last 40 years, and I think we can rework some things and make some things happen with the budget we have and a few tweaks and a little more proactive for San Franciscans instead of for everybody else. We have the best city in the world. There's no doubt about that. Everybody wants to come here. So let's make it the best city for us as well as for every tourist that comes and every other city in the world. That's my speech.
On behalf of the League of Women Voters and our partner organizations, the University of California, San Francisco, and SFGov TV, our thanks to the candidates for participating. Thank you. Thank you to our wonderful moderator, our hero, Maxine Anderson. And thanks to each of you for taking time to inform yourself about your choices on November the 3rd. Remember to register to vote, to register others to vote, and to vote. And as Maxine has said, be bold, educate, advocate, and act. Good night.